me, girl. What time tonight?
I don't know yet. I have to get out of taking my little brother trick-or-treating.
Saving treats for Bob.
Welcome to a very, very special edition of Psychobabble. Probably the volume or edition that I'm most excited about since I started doing Psychobabble movie reviews. The 1978 Halloween. John Carpenter's Halloween. So, let's get started. This review is going to have clips from the movie. This review is going to have the original trailer, but with a little bit of a modern day remix spin put on the trailer so that you guys can enjoy it a little bit more than I think you'd enjoy a 1978 trailer. I just can't wait. So let's get started. All right. While I watch the movie, I will be recording some of my comments during the movie. But before, I want you guys to take a peek at a brand new remixed version of the trailer. Tell me what you think.
15 years ago, I met this 6-year-old child with this blank, pale, emotionless face, the blackest eyes, the devil's eyes.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
I'm babysitting the Doyles. The Wallaces leave at 7.
I've come to talk with you again.
What about the boogeyman?
The boogeyman is coming!
There's no such thing. I mean, Halloween night, it's when people play tricks on each other. It's all make-believe. The boogeyman can only come out on Halloween night, right?
Right.
Well, I'm here tonight. I'm not about to let anything happen to you.
Promise?
Promise.
You know, it's Halloween. I guess everyone's entitled to one good scare, huh?
He's been here once. He's on his way. Tonight.
Families, children, all lined up in rows up and down these streets. You're telling me they're lined up for a slaughterhouse?
Death has come to your little town, Sheriff.
Okay, did you guys enjoy that version of the trailer? I really hope so, and please, if you're watching this, take the second to comment below, tell me how much you liked the trailer, and what was your thoughts on this classic movie that spawned so many other movies after it that copied it, because, let's be honest, since the producers of Friday the 13th have been honest, Friday the 13th and Jason would not have happened had it not been for Halloween. Many movies would not have happened had it not been for Halloween, including more up-to-date ones like Scream. All right. Play movie. All right, right from the get-go, I want to comment on everything that amazes me about the movie. Some things will be, nostalgic. There'll be things that I remember making me feel a certain way as a kid when I watched this. You know, I was 8 years old when this came out in theaters, and then it went to HBO and cable, and I remember watching it every year annually, still to this
day.
When
the movie opens, see, now when we watch it, we know that's Michael outside walking up to the house, walking around the house, looking at the girl and the boy, making out on the couch through a window.
You gotta imagine, when we first saw this movie, you didn't know that was a 6-year-old Michael Myers. Especially with the shot starting across the street walking up to the house. You thought it was a creep. And at that time, I remember as a kid, one of the creepiest and scariest things in your neighborhood or that you heard my aunts and my mom talk about was somebody standing outside in the dark being able to see everything you're doing inside because the light's on. I remember those nights. I remember hearing them talk about it. And this movie touched on it because John Carpenter had his finger on the pulse of what scared America at the time. When we see the hand in the clown suit reach in a kitchen drawer and pull out a butcher knife, little known fact,
That is producer Deborah Hill, her hand, getting the knife out of the drawer. The nurse that you see in the scene, the young nurse driving the car, returns 20 years later after this movie in Halloween H2O, playing the same character, still as a nurse. Something I never understood was why Michael's body language. It was as if he was two different people. When he was in the hospital gown, he leaped around and almost had the look of a demon flying up over the car because the red lights reflecting on his white gown and robe as he leaps onto the top of the car. But then later when he's in his jumpsuit and white mask, he walks as if he's a robot. In the same scene, if you look, here's a little bit more trivia for you. They didn't have sugar glass or anything like that. Remember, I said it was a low budget movie. To break the window to get to the nurse, he really did break a real car window. And if you watch in the movie, it's not difficult to see it. Taped to his hand right here is a wrench. Here comes the hand with the wrench. There it is. And you can see it clear too. Okay. Enter Laurie Strode. For the first time, Jamie Lee Curtis at 17 years old, her first movies, she signed a 3-movie deal, Halloween, Terror Train, and Prom Night. I just thought that was interesting. And that was her first 3 movies, by the way. And the whole thing, and this was addressed in Scream, the whole thing in horror movies about blaming horror movies for, boobs, it's ironic. This was addressed in Scream. Jamie Lee Curtis in all her movies, all the horror movies that gave her the nickname Scream Queen because she did so many of them, and yet she never showed any nudity in any of those. She never showed nudity until she did a topless scene in, of all things, a comedy, Trading Places, with Dan Aykroyd and Eddie Murphy. A little bit more trivia for you. Little known fact, unless you're a huge film fan or fan of Halloween, is Laurie Strode and Michael Myers was not brother and sister in this movie. Not at all. It wasn't in the script. The actors was never let know that that would eventually come into play, because guess what? The man who wrote and directed it did not know this. They were not brother and sister in the original Halloween. That was not brought on board until John Carpenter was contacted and desired to be the director or writer of a sequel. And he had to have a reason to carry the story on, and his reason, back in the day and age of everybody revealing that they were actually related to somebody else, it was happening every day on soap operas, happened in Star Wars with Luke, I am your father. And in this movie, no different. For a story to carry on for part two, that's when they wrote it in. Now, some of you might say, yeah, but what about... I saw the first Halloween, and they addressed that in that movie. Wrong. It wasn't until they were filming part two, and they had decided to make them brother and sister, that they had to go back and film additional footage for part one anyway for its television release, because Halloween was actually too short to fill the television spot's time slot. So they had to film, I forget how many extra minutes of film. So what they did was John Carpenter decided, well, this would be a good place to put in the original Halloween, the reveal that they're brother and sister, so that it'll make sense in the sequel. And that somebody won't one day go back and say what I'm saying right now. In the original, they were not brother and sister. Sorry if you don't like it, but it's true. Michael Myers went to the hospital for the insane at 6 years old for killing his older sister. He escapes later in his 20s. And he drove? This guy would not have developed driving skills. He would not have developed probably writing skills, let alone driving skills. And because of lack of creativity to come up with a better way how he got his ass to Haddonfield, he drove, and they don't know why or how. I call that a plot hole. Now, I may be the only one to ever say this, and maybe think it, but when Dr. Loomis meets the caretaker of the cemetery, am I the only one that would give anything all these years later to hear the rest of this line?
Watch eyeballs. about 15 years ago. One night he finished dinner and he excused himself.
If you can hear that.
And he went out to the garage and he got himself a hacksaw. And then he went back into the house and he kissed his wife and his two children goodbye. And then he proceeded.
Where are we?
It's right away.
Dr. Loomis cut him off right as he said, and then he proceeded to, he talks about somebody going out to the wood shop, or the shop, getting a hacksaw, coming back into the house, kissing his wife and his daughters goodbye, and then he proceeded to, and then Dr. Loomis cuts him off. Dr. Loomis don't give a damn. Dr. Loomis got other things to worry about, like the boogeyman. But I've always wanted to know what the rest of that story was, at least that line. According to Jamie Lee Curtis here, Lori Strode, the boogeyman can only come out on Halloween night.
Promise.
I'm going to have to beg to differ with her. Damn you for letting him go. In the Halloween movies, critics ripped this movie for making serial killers out of normal people. You heard me right. They said that when you put the viewer in the point of view, in the role of the killer, because they blamed the movie because they said all the shots were your point of view is Michael's point of view. The only time that it was Michael's point of view was at the very beginning when he was six. We are never looking at anything through Michael's point of view. It's our own POV, like we're there with Michael, if that's any better. I know, but still, they had it wrong. Because every time you're looking at what Michael's watching, it's always over his shoulder. So for it to be his point of view, that's like saying he has a set of eyes back there somewhere looking over his own shoulder. Very stupid. Critics need to pay closer attention to a movie if they're going to review it. Like I'm doing. Alright. This is another problem I had with the original and Rob Zombie's remake. Michael's using a butcher knife. It's maybe this long. This man's body, that he lifts up with one hand by the neck, sticks the knife all the way through him, then it pins him to the pantry door in the kitchen. Am I the only one that doesn't understand how a knife that long went all the way through his body and far enough through a door to suspend that mofo's body weight? How? You would need a frickin' sword. Stupid. Okay, I'm at that scene.
See anything you like?
Kind of. This badass boogeyman, Michael Myers, that took the time to put on a sheet, cut the eye holes out, and put the boyfriend's glasses on. I just never understood and thought Michael to do something like that. Now, Rob Zombie did improve this scene in the 2007 remake because he said showed that the boyfriend actually was doing this. We see him walking down the hallway dressed like that with the sheet, the eye holes cut out, and the glasses on. But Michael snatched his ass up, then killed him, and then came in the same sheet that the boyfriend had already cut the eye holes out and the boyfriend's glasses to kind of mess with her before killing her. But I can't see where Michael had the time to do this with the sheet. And just, I didn't like this scene. Didn't. Okay, I just thought of something I wanted to point out earlier, and I think I was too busy talking about something else. So I'm going to backtrack just for a moment here. One more fault I had with the movie. And I'm sorry, but I think when you're doing a movie review, you can't be biased and you got to point out things. When Michael was six and he was killing his older sister, Judith, he has the clown mask on. The point of view camera, the point of view is the camera through the eye holes. Instead of showing what he'd be looking at while he was killing her, the point of view through the eye holes turns up like this to show the hand doing this number into her. So that would mean while she was down here, instead of looking at what he's stabbing, he's going, it's stupid. Stupid. And when it comes time to do a scale from 1 to 10, it will pay. Not much. Even with its imperfections, I want to give it, I'm giving it a 9 out of 10. You know what? This might be the first time I've ever done this. I just said 9, but we watch it all these years later. People still watch it religiously every Halloween. How can you be better than that? I'm giving the 1978 original John Carpenter's Halloween a 10 on a scale from 1 to 10. A 10! There you have it. Halloween 1978, John Carpenter's film. It lives on and it will forever. It's become part of the holiday itself, so it deserves a 10 out of 10. On a scale from 1 to 10, it is a perfect 10. It's Halloween. And that is not just a bunch of psychobabble.
He was destined to his own fate. His own day of reckoning with himself. The idea is that destiny is a very real, concrete thing that every person has to deal with. How does Samuel's view of fate differ from that of Carl Kane?
Thank you.